So we're going to walk 10 blocks down to Tomacall Park near Hawthorne and actually flying down there. And I'm going to go in reverse order. So I'll talk about our software and our mapping system first, because it's often hard to drag people back inside and explain that after we go outside. And then we'll walk down, and hopefully within the hour and a half time period, we should be able to fill and fly and return. It's going to be a little tight, so it might be like a couple minutes over getting back here. But so I'm Mathew Lippincott, as Damon mentioned. I helped found this nonprofit, the Public Laboratory for Open Technology and Science, or Public Lab, publiclab.org. Our goal has been to make inexpensive, low-cost hardware tools that enable communities to do their own environmental health investigations. So we started around mapping the Gulf oil spill with balloons and kites. And we also have a spectrometry project which we work on, and some infrared cameras, which I'll show you if you walk down to the waterfront. But the basic problem is, or our problem definition for mapping is, so say you live in some place where you need good map data and there isn't any aerial imagery for your space. It says OpenStreetMap is doing a great job on this on the vector mapping side, but what do you do if you need imagery? Well, aerial imagery, especially low altitude aerial imagery from planes or helicopters or kites and balloons, as I'm going to show you today, gets you the highest resolution, the best development of the ground. So this is South Tel Aviv. Shai Afradi was working on mapping here. And if you look, you'll notice that Google won't give you anything better than like 3 meter imagery. So as we zoom in, you know, the city's quite blurry. And in terms of using this data, I mean, you can't really identify anything. So from an urban planning perspective, they're looking at neighborhood redevelopment and they'd like good imagery. And so this is a map made in our software, MapKnitter, by Shai and his team using a kite. And I believe they're flying from this park over here or that park over there. Wasn't there. But what they got were a whole series of rectangular images, which using MapKnitter, and I'll show you that in a second, they sorted and stitched on top of the existing imagery to get a fairly high resolution map. So this one is 5 centimeters per pixel, so about 100 times better than the imagery publicly available. And you don't need to actually fly a kite or a balloon to get imagery and use our MapKnitter software. So one of my favorite use cases is this project that we've been speculating about, passenger pigeon, where people take photos out of the sides of airplane windows while traveling. So I don't know if any of you are here from out of town, or no. Everyone's here from Portland or Oregon generally. I see Lynn County.
Eugene.
I
don't know if that counts as out of town for what you're talking about here.
Yeah. Well, I was just saying, you know, if you're flying home, you could, you know, pick up some imagery, track your flight, and figure out what time you are in your flight, and use either flight stats or flight tracker to figure out roughly where the images were, and do something like take an image of the recently redeveloped Arizona State Prison out of your window, and then this imagery we handle on the back end with MapKnitter, we handle GDAL and all the geographic formatting. So you know, you can get a GeoTIFF or other file, and it'll end up in Google Maps. So here is my old backyard and garden. Space was recently sold by its landlord. You'll notice there's a nice bright patch from a sunny day when I was flying a balloon out there. And Google's dropped that into their base layer. Now, unfortunately, Google has now gotten higher resolution imagery, so when we zoom in, they get rid of it. But at the time, you know, I wanted to map. I just put up this greenhouse, and you know, we just opened up a whole bunch of beds. We had garlic growing over here, you know. So I wanted to get a nice imagery of it, and here it is. The whole map making process is pretty cheap. There's about $350 worth of stuff strapped to my bike over there. We'll probably only use like half of that, but if you wanted to get into flying stuff and making maps, it's pretty cheap. And this is a tool, Map Knitter. So here I've loaded up Cocodrie, Louisiana, because we have this great X-shaped building that's really easy to reform your rubber sheet your image onto. And so I just clicked upload an image, uploaded one image, and just need to rotate it and scale it. So this is all running in a browser. Anybody here works on making Bitnami stacks for offline web applications? Really be interested in some help on that. So I'm going to rescale it to the best of my abilities here. Kind of identify a couple of landmarks, like this ring road is really helping me line up the image right now. And then I'll just keep toggling this image outline. And it looks like, I have a little distortion. This image that we took from the air, and this is from a balloon flight in January, is off at a bit of an angle. So I'm going to switch to distort mode and make my image a little transparent so I can really line this up. So we're getting really close. Our ground features are lining up. You'll notice that ring road is pretty close, and this pier is in roughly the same area. Now, this is a much lower altitude image, so the building itself is actually going to be distorted in relation to the ground plane. That's pretty typical in urban areas because, if you're only flying at 500 or 600 feet, the altitude of the building is significant enough that you kind of have to choose what plane you're rectifying to. So here, I care about the wetlands. The building itself is just a convenient way to get there. So that's the kind of last stage of it. And as I said, I'm going to move backwards on this. But earlier in the process, I've got this problem of, okay, so I went out and I wanted to make a map. And here is like a raw data set. It's a little too big. This is from trying to map the garden in my neighborhood. This is with an infrared camera. So the red channel is actually passing near infrared light. And this is much lower altitude. I have a lot more photos, and I need to come up with a sorting schema. So what I do is I have a Mac, and I load them all up in preview, just load all my images. And I make this sidebar nice and big, and just scroll through them, think, oh, there's someone drinking coffee, that's not really that important. And then find, okay, so there we go, we're getting into the air, we're putting up this pole, And the way we did it here was we kind of ran the pole around in a circle. And so I just copied the images out of Map Knitter until I got these circular panoramas of chunks of the garden, all sorted. And that's how I get enough sorted images to be able to go back here and drop them into Map Knitter. So once I have an image here, I'm ready to go export it. I can export it in, I can pick the resolution. So if I don't actually want a high resolution imagery, or this is picking an average resolution based on the average resolution of the different photos. But if I know some of the photos are high res and I want to just get a really big file, I can pick a different resolution here. And when I export, I'll get GeoTIFFs and other files that you can load in other programs. But I'll also be able to take it into Potlatch 2, which is one of the OpenStreetMap editors, and be able to trace the imagery to get vector street data as well. So are there any questions on this process? So we're going to go into the more interactive stage of this and try to head down to the waterfront and actually do some photography. But before we do that, maybe we go around the room and introduce ourselves and what your interest in map making is. So again, I'm Matthew. And Muffin. So we have good muffins. That's important.
I'm Leanna, and I'm very interested in greatly designing connecting maps, but also is that I finally hit upon my project, like capital P, was like, well, if you really want to learn to program like for really real, you need a project that you care about. And I've been taking a lot of pictures of sidewalk contractor stamps and concrete.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. I'm Derek. I like to take strangers on places, so I tend to look at maps when I'm out. So I haven't been historically so good in the production part of them. But I mean, those of you who saw the talk that I gave a couple of days ago, I noticed that I was really using Google Maps to display properties. Maybe something useful there. So I'm just here to see what you do.
Cool.
So we're taking that down somewhere.
Yeah, we're going down to Tahmacall Waterfront. We have 60 cubic feet worth of helium. I've got we have enough strings that three people can be flying at once. We'll see if we have enough space for that, but yeah. And it looks like yeah, we have enough we do teams of two on flying, and we got a lot of people. Cool. Welcome. Oh, no, I expect that. You know, I go to the PDX drones meetups, And the thing I find is that I'm always in the air first because the wind's a little too high, or there's like, and so someone's staring at their $6,000 drone going like, oh, I don't know if I want to go in the air. And that's why I fly $60 kites with $20 cameras I get on Craigslist. Because... Oh, nice. Right, so no matter what you're flying, flying is very much like surfing. Does anyone here surf? I don't surf, but okay. This is what I've been told. And the big thing is, you know, this is a weather-dependent activity. So thank you, NOAA, America's oldest and most awesome open science project, the National Weather Database, done largely by volunteers who call in or email in weather data. And then they produce these wonderful forecasts. So this is today, and we're here. And so our balloon, we really don't want to be flying above 10-mile-an-hour winds. So we're actually entering a range where hopefully we get a balloon in the air, and it'll be good. We're going to watch it. And then as we get above 5 miles an hour, we might be able to put a kite in the air. And so we're right at that cusp, and that's why we have kites and balloons. And then there is a fairly good chance, right, there's a fairly good chance it's going to rain. They were saying yesterday that it wasn't going to rain until about 3, but we do have to watch out for rain. Luckily, here in the Willamette Valley, we don't really have to watch out for lightning, and I also got y'all to sign liability waivers, so. Right? So, right, my first first place I go, and this is like, I'll often bring a kite to work just for fun, and I'll be sitting there, and in the background I'll have this NOAA weather data open, kind of crossing my fingers, I can go fly it. And the other thing I like using when I'm going to a place I don't know is the wind history map, windhistory.com. This is awesome. You can go in and they'll take the NOAA weather data from most of the weather stations. For some reason, I don't know why in Portland, but the Lloyd Center and other weather stations don't show up with wind history, but you get this wonderful bar graph, and you can see, you pick the month. I don't know why January is also selected, but here's like, this is June's weather data. So we know in June most of the time the wind's blowing west. In fact, today the wind should be blowing southwest. So we should be in a good place to go down to Tomacall Park and be able to map the waterfront with the balloon. We're going to be putting it up and taking it down around the bridges, but that'll be it. So the next thing to do is, again, use Google Maps or any other aerial mapping group and go look at your flight area. And you know, it's best to actually know the place. I live here, so I do know the waterfront pretty well. But you know, go, and you may want to print out a map. Here, our route's not very complicated. We're just taking this trail. So I wasn't bothering to print out the map, but we're going to walk down here to the waterfront, and we have a nice open space for experimentation. And you know, if our if something does go wrong, it'll probably go wrong into the river, which is nice. So, all right. So let's go for a walk.